Today, I'm going to talk about a couple of new features that were added as a part of C# 11. The first one that I'm going to discuss today is the introduction of a new keyword named required. To understand what this new keyword is and in which scenarios we will need to use it, let us consider a class user. And the user class has three properties: the name, the address, and the phone number. And this class do not have any constructor defined. Now, if we want to create an instance of this class using the object initializer, we do not know which properties are needed during the construction of the object versus which ones are good to set later or which one we do not even need to set at all throughout the life cycle of the object. There is no clear contract defined by the class which makes it obvious. For example, if I get into the program now and try to create an instance of user, I really don't know which ones are required or not, and I can just go ahead and create the user object like this. Now, if we go to user, you can see that the name, address, and phone number, all the three are showing the green squiggly because they are non-nullable parameter and we have not declared them as nullable. So we can do this to get rid of this, but it still does not solve our main problem, which is the caller or the place where the object is created do not have any clue which of the properties are mandatory. So now here, if we just go ahead and set the name property, it will work fine and compile because the compiler doesn't know which all properties are required. And this is exactly where the new required keyword helps us. So if we go here in the user again, and if we add the required keyword in front of a property, we are declaring that it is required as a part of the contract. So if I go ahead and make address as required, there are a couple of things happening. So first thing, you can see that the green squiggly, which was the non-nullable property indicator of the compiler, is gone now, which is the green squiggly. And then what is going to happen is, if I go back here, you can see that the user object is now showing a red squiggly, which means that it is going to fail if we compile this, because it says required member addressed must be set in the object initializer or attribute constructor. Now we'll get back to the attribute constructor a little later, but let's focus on the object initializer. So which means now we have to provide the address. And if we see the definition here also, it shows address as required. So we can set the address now. And you can see that the error is gone. So this is the first usage of the required keyword. And now the next thing also, the same support is now available for attribute. So I have declared an attribute called role attribute, and the role attribute has a property called type, which is required. Now, if I go ahead and try to use the role attribute, let's say for example, the user class. So if I go here and I say role, you can see that role is now showing a red squiggly, which is compile time error. And it says that required member role attribute dot type must be set in the object initializer or attribute constructor. And here now we can go ahead and set the type, and we can say type is equal to test. So now you can see the red squiggly error is gone, and now the attribute can also have a proper contract defining which all properties are necessary during object initialization. So the next feature that I want to talk about today is the raw string literals. And the raw string literals is denoted by three double quotes. For example, if I go ahead and let me get rid of these, as we do not need it anymore. Let's say we have a string, and here I can declare var content is equal to, and let's say the string is, this is a test string. So let's say this is our string. And as you can see, this particular string has a double quote inside of the string. So now if we have to make it work, you can see it's already showing a red squiggly. Now, if we have to make it work, we'll have to add escape character. So the way to do it is we can add a couple of escape character and it's going to work fine. But with the new string literals, we don't have to do it. All we have to do it is make it as triple quote, put a space here and then triple quote. We are good to go. Now, if I don't give a space here, then the compiler doesn't know where is the delimiter, where it stops. So that's why I have to give a space to ensure that this is the last three double quotes, which indicates that this is inside the raw string literal. And then the next thing is if we want to put the things into a different line. So let's say we say, and this is in next line. We can do like this, but as you can see, if we do like this, it is not working. So this is critical to remember that if we want the same string literal to be divided into multiple lines, we have to start at the first character of the first line itself in the next line. So we start like this, and then we can enter this, and then the last three double quotes also has to be the last line. And once we do that, you can see this is moving. And you can see that I cannot go, these last three double quotes cannot go beyond the last delimited item here, otherwise we'll get an error. So it has to be here or here, or it can go further, but it cannot go beyond this. And the reason for this is the way you format here. So if I put a tab here, and once I do a console.write line of this particular text, it will print exactly the way I provided here. So if I go and do a console.write line of content, and if I run this, you will see that it will keep the indentation that I created appropriately. And you can see that it is indented properly. And you can see that there's a tab here because I started with a tab here. Now, if I get rid of this tab and keep two tabs here, it is going to behave exactly the same. The first line will start from the left corner, and there is two tabs for the next line. Now, if we also want to do a string interpolation here, and let's say we want to get a variable. So this is a test string. Instead of we get the string from a different variable, we can do the following. So far, let's declare var, let's say this is body, and here body text. Now we can come here and we can do body, but for that we have to give the dollar here. So as soon as we add the dollar at the beginning, just like we do it today, the body will be recognized, and if we run this, we are going to see the appropriate behavior as expected. Now, if we add two curly braces here, then what is going to happen? It is going to fail. If we are getting a compile time error itself. It says the interpolation roasting does not start with enough dollar. And it is exactly like what we have to do. Basically have to add one more dollar and we'll be good. Similarly, if we have three curly braces here, then we have to use $3. Now, if I run this, you can see that it is working as expected. Now, the next feature that we can do here is also with respect to double quotes. So for example, here, if we add three double quotes, for some reason, we want to show three double quotes. Now, this whole thing will start failing. But we can fix it with a simple adding one more double quotes here and one in the end, and now everything just works. And if we run this, we'll see three double quotes in the output. And we can see three double quotes, body text, three double quotes, as expected. So this is another feature which is going to be useful in certain situation. I do not think in my own personal experience, this will be widely used in the work that we usually do in day-to-day basis. Whereas the required keyword is very critical. And I think when it comes to overall architecture and design of an application, providing a proper contract as a part of the object initialization is very critical. Now, the next feature that I wanted to discuss is file access modifier. So now we can create top level type within a file with file access modifier, which will make this type available only to the file. So to show that, let's create a new class and we can name it as user provider. And as a part of this, the another thing I wanted to show you is another big convenience feature that is added by Visual Studio is now, if I provide a semicolon here, you see that the curly braces of namespace is gone already. Earlier, before this version, I had to go and manually delete those and I've also intended the class properly. Now the class is also intended appropriately. So this is a huge feature. So now here, what we can do is we can add a file access modifier class. So we can say file class and let's create user, same type. Because it is at the file level, it is not available outside of this file itself. And now here we can have a property, let's say string name, and let's just return a name here, test name. And now here we can create again a name property. And for the name property, you can just do new user dot name. And this is absolutely fine. It will work perfectly. So if we go here and let me get rid of this, we can say var user new of user provider. And here we can do user provider dot name. And if we run, we'll see the new name is being printed out in the console output, the test name, as expected. But there are a couple of things to keep in mind is that, first of all, we cannot expose this user outside. So if I change this as user instead of string and get rid of this here, let's say, you'll see that the file local type user cannot be used in a member signature in non-file local type user provider. So this is critical to understand. This is basically we cannot expose file outside, which is obvious. We kind of knew that because it is part of this file. So it is nothing surprising. Now, one question you might have is, what is the difference between a private and a file? Now, the fundamental difference is you cannot declare anything as private at a namespace level. You just cannot. You cannot have a private class. The private class needs to be part of an internal or public class, whereas that is not the case for file. File can be declared as a top level type inside of a namespace, but accessible only to the types which are inside of this file. So this is a fundamental difference that we have to keep in mind. So these are the three other features that I wanted to cover as a part of today's video. In my last video, I did cover two of the most interesting features which I felt will be really useful for day-to-day usage for C# 11. These are, in my opinion, the next set of features which I will see using in my day-to-day. And I personally feel like file class and the required keyword will be used more often compared to the raw string literals. So that is all I wanted to cover for today's video. If you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. And if you are new to my channel and you think you are getting value out of my channel, please subscribe to my channel. And thanks so much for watching this video.